Hello and welcome to the AMA Update video and podcast. Today we're talking about what success looks like in value-based care and how the AMA's CPT codes can help you get there. Our guest today is Lori Prestesater, Senior Vice President of Health Solutions at the AMA in Chicago. I'm Todd Unger, AMA's Chief Experience Officer. Lori, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me. I'm delighted to be here today.
Excellent. Well, before we dive in and talk more about specifically about the interaction with CPT and value-based care, talk to us a little bit about value-based care. It's a topic that comes up again and again in our discussions with many of our health system partners. Why is it getting so much traction right now?
So, you know, it's really about redefining the traditional way that we've delivered care. And, you know, who delivers the care, where the care is delivered, and in most cases, how the care is paid for. You know, during the pandemic, we saw a huge influx of digitally enabled care, right? So it really accelerated, I would say, the path to value-based care. We've been talking about value-based care for a very long time with little progress. We are now seeing a surge of people moving to value-based care and needing to be able to accommodate those new payment models.
Now, I don't know if I'm wrong here, but when you say value-based care, maybe the first thing people associate, it might not be CPT codes, right? So just give us kind of a high-level overview of what that interaction looks like.
Sure. And you're right. It's probably not the first thing they think about. You know, CPT has kind of been the foundation and of how we define medical services since 1966, believe it or not. But it's been always associated with a traditional fee-for-service model of care. It really is the standard used to define medical procedures and services, and it fits very well in a fee-for-service model. However, it also really provides the foundation for value-based care when you think about the need to do research, clinical research. You have to account for those services. You think about the need to establish a cost, the need to do and support interoperability so that we can have seamless records across different, you know, different care settings. So CPT is really still a foundational building block as we think about when we move to value-based care.
Well, let's talk a little bit more in detail. You've created a new report called Accelerating the Adoption of Value-Based Care, and in that, you outline three pillars of success. Let's start with the first one.
Absolutely. So population health and quality management would be the first pillar. And, you know, I'd like to say we established those, but really I think they're industry standards. We're just, CPT is fitting into the industry standard, you know, in all ways that we can to support moving care forward. So really talking about population health is talking about providing the right care at the right time in the right setting, and doing so in a way that can improve quality and reduce cost, ideally preventing expensive downstream events of care. So keeping people out of the emergency room, keeping people, you know, out of settings of care when we can, preventative care, and how we do that in a way that's effective for them, for the physician, and frankly, for the payer.
How can practices, or what can practices do to address that particular issue?
So, you know, really, CPT, most models are built on some kind of attribution model. So a practice has a panel of patients attributed to them using some method. And in order to do that attribution, CPT really provides the foundation that helps to support that attribution that can then establish the baseline for metrics. You know, how are those patients going to be managed? How are those patients going to be measured? What can we do to increase the outcomes while we manage the cost? You know, a great example would be Blue Cross Blue Shield, Horizon Blue Cross Blue Shield of New Jersey, who would say they use CPT as the foundation in order to negotiate and manage those value-based arrangements with their physician practices. They can set the baseline for care, they can set the baseline for cost, and then they can identify areas that they might need physician education, they might, you know, have areas that of improvement or things that they should tweak in the model.
Now, you mentioned the word cost, which happens to be pillar number two. So why is that so important for success in value-based care?
Well, I don't care who you are or where you are in healthcare, everyone has cost pressures. And so being able to account for that cost, identify the cost, manage the cost, and then manage improving it is something that is universal. And CPT allows you to, at a detail level, identify that unit of cost.
So tell us more about that. Exactly how does that work?
So, you know, CPT is the foundational layer to identify a procedure or a service. No matter what payment model you're in, you have the cost of providing that service. And you have to build a bundle of costs, if you will, to get to a value-based arrangement. So you have to budget for that. You have to staff for it. You have to account for it. You have to be able to manage it and measure it. A lot of people use it to do network management to most effectively manage that cost. So CPT, again, really provides that foundational baseline or benchmark for to use.
Now, you mentioned kind of whatever payment model you're working.
Yeah.
And in fact, the third pillar does relate to alternative payment model contracting. So what do we need to know about that?
So in almost any of these models, a practice or whomever has to get patients attributed to them. And in many cases, it's based on where the predominance of care is provided, which again, CPT allows you to track. So you can assign the patients to the right physician, provider, however the panel works or the payment model works. Now, the other thing, as I mentioned, during the pandemic, we've seen this rise in digitally enabled care vendors, models, new models of care that are extending the traditional bundle of care provided. It's, you know, increasing access. It's, you know, providing patient convenience. But it's also challenging payers and providers to find new models that support a bundle of care that may involve a number of patient encounters that could be digitally based, they could be self-monitoring, but the bundle of care can be triggered by a CPT code. So during the pandemic and even before, the panel evolved a number of new CPT codes to support these new care models and the new way care is being delivered. So a great example would be, you know, you trigger a bundle, it may have multiple encounters, but you only want one copay. So you really have to have new ways to manage those models of care as they continue to evolve. And they will keep changing. They'll be refined, and the CPT code set and the CPT panel will need to and have, but will continue to need to evolve to support those new models as they, you know, evolve.
It's so interesting. Just the theme of this is adaptation, and part of that is to new care models. Part of it is adjusting to what other pandemic is
right.
thrown at us. It's been really informative to hear about that connection. Anything else you want to leave our audience with?
I would just like to say that, as you know, hopefully you've heard today and just referenced, as the world continues to evolve, you know, the AMA and the CPT editorial panel will seek to continue to understand and evolve right along with it. So, you know, we appreciate the engagement from the community in helping us to learn and evolve, and we continue to be open to do so.
Well, Lori, thank you so much for being here today. I found that really fascinating, very interesting. We're going to be sure to include a link to the report in the description of this episode, and I encourage everyone out there to take a look. If you found this discussion valuable, you can support more programming like it by becoming an AMA member at ama-assn.org/join. That wraps up today's episode, and we'll be back soon with another AMA update. Be sure to subscribe for new episodes and find all our videos and podcasts at ama-assn.org/podcasts. Thanks for joining us today. Please take care.